Hello gamers, Shion here with another Last Epoch video about my Falconeer Ballista turret build. Ballistas that shoot themselves, so no exploding ballistas. I made two videos about this build in the last week and I got a lot of good reactions from it. And also some questions whether it's viable for leveling or not. And if I could make a leveling build, so here it is. A little build on how to, a little guide on how to level with this build. I did it myself in release, actually. Started with this on the morning of release for me in Europe. And within a couple of hours, I had cleared the campaign of it and was on to farming monoliths. So it worked very well for me. And I will tell you how I did it and how you can do it too. So for more information on the build, please check my previous videos. They will demonstrate how it works at endgame, how to gear the end game and how it works defensively. Basically, you put down your ballistas, they shoot things, you use your movement skill, the ballistas go with you, you use your falcon abilities to kill things. It's very smooth and you can always keep moving to dodge things while the ballistas kill everything. And in campaign it's also wonderful because you can pretty much just run through the map while your ballistas shoot everything and get you XP even if stuff dies off screen. So it's great for just running through the campaign and early monoliths after that and surviving. So let's first start with how this build would level during the campaign. The ballista skill, you get it at level 15, I believe. So until then, you have to use something else. Let me pull up the browser here where I made some example builds. This is the first build I made for leveling. Starting from level 1, you can follow this guide. And I recorded the passive tree so that you can scroll here, like start from level 1 and see which nodes I take all the way up to late game. We start off taking the damage nodes here. The dexterity, the attack speed, the physical damage. Until we get Ballista at 15 skill points. And then we continue for until we have 20 points in here. So we're ready to start putting points in Falconry once we unlock that. Once we get Falconry, we immediately try to take this all the way up until we get Aerial Assault and Dive Bomb. And that will pretty much be the leveling that we do during campaign. The additional nodes will just put in more into more damage here, as well as in the side nodes for additional dexterity. Note that we're purely focusing on offensive nodes here, right? So dexterity, damage, mana gain on hit, also some life, of course. But we're skipping these nice defensive nodes like glancing blow chance and whatnot, because you're pretty much solid enough to get through the campaign without worrying too much about defensive nodes and glancing blow early on. You'll do so much damage that your ballistas and your falcon will just kill everything. So until we get to monoliths, don't worry too much about defense. At least not to your nodes. And your gear, that's another matter, but I'll get to that. As for skills, at the very beginning, we'll start off taking a puncture and acid bomb or acid flask, but we're not actually going to level acid flask. We're not going to put any points into it. Or, well, you can actually, but you're going to have to respec it very soon. Because as soon as we get Ballista, we can pretty much get rid of Acid Flask. Or at least we don't want to put points into it anymore. But we do want Puncture early on. Because the Falconry nodes, like Falconry itself, but more specifically Dive Bomb and Aerial Assault, they are very late, so you won't have them during the beginning of the campaign. So instead of Aerial Assault and Dive Bomb, we're running Shift and Puncture. That also means that the crit necklace that we're using, the Gambler's Fallacy, it won't work because we're using the Puncture bow skills, which will remove our 100% crit chance. So early on, we do like crit chance during the campaign. That's why we also take those notes in the skill tree where possible. So we start off with Puncture. You can see here how I progress it. Quickly want these nodes so we can do really quick shots in between our movement. and some armor shred to support the ballistas. At level 15 we take ballista, we put that in our second skill slot. We start leveling this, first going for this big node. It will give us the most damage, then we go up to these shared crit and shared damage nodes. Just make them scale with your gear. And then we go into duration and the rest. You can see in the next build I made for the later game leveling. Then we take shift. Nothing too important here, just some healing on use and some invulnerability. This one is nice to get to dodge some things early on. This is pretty much just move around the map. This is until we get aerial assault. Then falconry, as soon as we reach chapter 4 and unlock our mastery. Pretty much the main node we want to go for here is this. It will give us some nice health every time the falcon hits enemies and a little bit of mana. And then this to kill bosses at 16%. And then finally spec into these nodes. Final skill at level 50 is smoke bomb. Not too big of a deal, just a little support skill for when the going gets rough, so to say, on the bosses maybe. Not that important. It's just you can also pick something else if you like. Gear wise, you want to look for rares with good modifiers for a build, of course. I made an example here of what to look for, just some simple items with good affixes. Like if you find a bow physical damage, flat physical damage, that's great. Try to get this a high tier. Getting physical damage is nice. This is a great mod, of course, bow and melee minion damage if you can find it, but it's very rare. But also other mods are great, like just normal physical damage. Like this percentage-based physical damage is nice. The crit modifiers are good early on. Basically just whatever you can get. Just try to get a nice base type for your bow. So low level you can get this one, for example, but later on you might find this plus 33% bow damage. It's a big upgrade over this, you know, because this base damage stat is the most important. It scales to your ballista and makes it deal a lot of damage. On armor piece, we mostly want to get dexterity, health, and resistances. Here I put elemental resist on it, but any type of resistance that you're lacking is good here. I think elemental resist is usually better to get than separate frost, fire, lightning, for obvious reasons, because it's more value. But you know, just take what you get. Mostly focus on your dexterity and health, I would say. On your necklace, you want to look for minion damage, crit, and health. Whatever you can find, basically, just offensive stats and your suffixes, health and resistance if you can get it. On your chest piece, try to find one with plus one maximum ballista. It's a pretty rare mod, so you might not find it until the end of the campaign. But other than that, just the same stats as you want on your other armor pieces are good, like dexterity and health. For your quiver, same story as the bow. You want flat physical damage, you want dexterity. Armor shred on hit is an important suffix here. You should try to craft this on there if you can. You can also find that mod on relic, for example, or an amulet, so it's not limited to bow, to quiver, I mean. For your rings, same story, just get dexterity and damage. Look for these rings with minion damage, crit multi, crit chance, these are good early on. For your belt, if you find an imprisoned mage, and it drops this belt with mana on potion use, then you should definitely take it. It's a great mod to have early. And otherwise, just go for the same stats as on the other armor pieces. Glove, same story. You can get crit chance on this as well. It's nice early on. On the boots, try to get this this mod that the mages drop with minion damage and minions teleport around with traversal skill. If you can't find that, it's no big deal, because early on the ballistas won't have too much duration anyway. But it's nice if you can get this. It's worth having terrible mods on the other affixes for this. Relic, you can get plus level on ballista on this. If you can find that, that's great. If you don't, no big deal. Just pick something else with nice stats. So that's pretty much for the early game, for the campaign. Another few things to mention, if you reach chapter 2 in the campaign, there's a quest called Urza's Ledger. It will have two options at the end of the quest, where you either talk to Artem or Urza. If you talk to Artem, he will give you this unique item called Gambler's Fallacy. This is the only way to get this item. Artem's Offer, the quest is called, actually, yeah. This is the only way to get that item, so make sure to do that. You won't be using it during the leveling, but you will use it later in the game. The quest might be disabled right now, I'm not too sure. It could be that they disabled it because it was bugged. But once that's working again, try to get this this one-in-a-lifetime chance necklace from that quest. If you don't get this necklace, then not that big of a deal, because late game you can replace it with this other unique that you can farm for. But it would be nice to have this early on. So do that in chapter 2 if you haven't made your character yet or are going to make a new character. Other tips, use a nice loot filter. If you just use the default loot filter, you will get way too much drops and you will spend a lot of time waiting on checking out all the items. So definitely install a nice loot filter or make one yourself. I actually made a loot filter. I will show it at the end of the video, and I will also put it in the description for you to use. Loot all the shards that you find, because you will need it for crafting, and early on you won't have many shards, especially if it's your first character. Speaking of crafting, if you get an item with a good modifier, like a high tier flat physical, for example, and this bow, or something else with a high mod, then it can be worth crafting on some other stats that you like health, resistance, whatever you need to supplement. Personally, I didn't craft too much during the campaign, only before the Lagon boss fight to make that easier. But it's definitely worth doing it if you feel like you're going too slow. Okay, so the second part of this guide will be the post-campaign leveling guide. Once you reach like level 60, 65, and you've cleared the campaign, or at least cleared up to the part where you can choose between the Merchant's Guild and the Circle of Fortune. You've already unlocked monoliths at that point, so the campaign phase is over at that point, in my regard. At that point, you will start to transition to build a little bit. You will start to look for this amulet that you get through the quest. If you don't get it through the quest, then you're going to have to farm the Soulfire Bastion to try and get this Soul Gambler's Fallacy. It's only available in the Soulfire Bastion at the end of the dungeon where you gamble for amulets. You can get this, it's build enabling, so try to get this as soon as you can. So what changes at the end game when you're like level 65, level 70? First of all, your skills are going to be transitioning to dive bomb and aerial assault. This will enable this node here in Tactician, which will massively boost our ballistas when we jump, and it will let them scale with intelligence. So this makes a huge difference to our damage output. And dive bomb as well is just much better than puncture, because it won't trigger your amulet, so you don't ever lose your 100% crit chance, and it just kills entire packs of mobs on use. So great note. At this point of the game, we make some slight changes to our passive tree as well. You can check out the build and the link, the build and the description from the link. I just made some small change and also added some defensive nodes here, like getting to high glancing blow chance as a defensive layer. Other than that, we're not bothering with ward yet. That's at the very end game, once you have the build enabling uniques like Exsanguineous and these gloves. Until we get those items, we are sticking with pure health as a defensive layer and just getting items with damage on it. Look for items with tier 5, tier 6, tier 7 modifiers that you like. A good implicit like this plus 60 bow damage bow. Try to seal some affixes here and there when you can with Scroll of Despair. Like this example here, I go for three affixes because they're all great boosts, and then one suffix. This minion melee damage, minion bow damage, try to craft this on, it's great. For the chest, again, we stick to maximum ballista. That's the most important. If you're really lucky, you can get plus two ballista even. Highly recommend it. It is better than any unique chest at this point. For the helm, we're going to look for this bone clamor barboot. It's quite easy to get. Once you've reached the Circle of Fortune, you should be able to target farm this pretty easily using the prophecies. If you didn't go Circle of Fortune but went Merchant's Guild, that's fine too, then just buy it off the auction house. I have no experience with this system, so can't really comment on it. Yeah, we're using this necklace to get 100% crit on our ballista and our falcon. How this works exactly, it's kind of, you're kind of abusing this necklace because you get the 100% crit chance because you're never dealing crit chance, critical strike chance directly. So the 50% less never applies. So you will always crit on all your ballista shots. The quiver, we're going to look for a base type of crit multi and some nice affixes like flat damage, dexterity, armor shred again. Pretty much the same as in the earlier leveling. For the rings, particularly we're going to be looking out for opal rings because of the cooldown reduction and the all attributes. Craft some mods like this on it, like dexterity, minion damage. Turquoise rings, also good options because of the minion damage, minion crit multi. Can be good to use if you don't find opal rings because these are quite rare and they require level 74. So they're a little bit more late game. Actually, these also require a high level. But I think that's because of the mods I added, actually. Never mind. This guy is normally level 52. For the belts, again, we like this mana on potion use, but it's not too needed unless you're really struggling with mana, which you probably are early game. So honestly, I recommend trying to get that. I also recommend crafting on this this ward on ailment cleansing on potion use if you can get this, because it will remove all dots like poison and bleed from you if you use a potion. For the gloves, we're going to be using Blood Roost. It's quite easy to farm, but if you don't find it, no big deal. It just gives you some levels in falconry and a lot of life leech on your falcon hits, so great to have. On the boots, we really want to aim for this mod, so use this over anything else. Kill as many mages you can and you will get this sooner or later. And again, for the relic, we are looking for a level of ballista, ideally a tier 6 or tier 7 for that juicy plus 4 ballista level. That is the dream, of course, but might take a while to find. As for idols, we're looking for health, resistances. These rogue idols can be really nice, but they're very rare in my experience. And these are also good if you can get them with the bow physical damage for ballista. The plan at this point of the game is just to get to empowered monoliths as soon as you can. Farm these empowered monoliths for your blessings. Once you have all your blessings, then you start pumping up the corruption on one of the monoliths, the one that you think is easiest, or the boss that you like the most. Get high corruption and then farm for tier 7 exalted items and rare uniques that will enable your endgame builds. As for blessings, I put the normal ones here, but the empowered ones are obviously better. We want to get this crit multi. We want to get old resist from the dragons. Armor is nice, but there are other options here, like minion damage is also good if you want more offense. Physical shred on hit is the best from Age of Winter. And here we can get plus mana. That is nice. You could also get this health regen or ward per second, but I think the mana is best. It will make it much more comfortable to play. That is the the end game leveling. Once we have found our uniques that we want, namely Exangenius, Gloss with a high mod for missing health per ward, we can start trying to farm these kind of uniques like Foot of the Mountain with high stats on it, a high LP bow, these rings, of course. Yeah, that is more endgame stuff. The reason why we're going for intelligence in the endgame here on our free stats is because intelligence at this point will scale your damage and your defense, because you have this this node here, right? This will scale your damage based on your intelligence, and it will also give you more ward retention. And more ward retention means a bigger ward pool because you're using ward per second. So basically, intelligence will be our god stat at this point. You might think, oh, it's only 2% ballista damage per intelligence. It's not that big of a deal, right? I mean, dexterity gives 4%. Well, dexterity does give 4%, but this is a separate multiplier. So if you already have a lot of dexterity, you might have like, 400% damage from dexterity. And then if you get like 50 int, then that will be plus 100% damage from int. But this will be multiplied with your 400% dexterity. So it will end up being much, much more valuable than if you would have another 50 dexterity, for example. It might be difficult to understand, but just trust me, you want intelligence once you start running ward. It will scale up your damage and your defense. So yeah, I think that's all I have to say about leveling with this build. It's really smooth. I will definitely play it again next cycle if it's not nerfed into the ground. Oh yeah, and finally I want to show you the loot filter that I made. Switch over back to the last epoch here. Didn't get disconnected yet. So I made a little loot filter. I might have to update a little bit, actually. It's not complete yet. I also haven't tested it out, so it might have some bugs here and there. So use this at your own discretion. I'm hiding all items by default. Then I will show all uniques that we can use as rogues. So it hides all other weapons. If you want to find these for other classes, then feel free to change this. But I'm not planning to play other classes this cycle. So I'm hiding these uniques. I show all experimentals, all items until I reach level 8, just to get some basic stuff on. Then until I reach level 30, anything with a decent mod on it will be shown. These are all the mods that I like to use while leveling. From level 30 to 50, I want at least two of these useful mods in my items. I'm showing all idols until I reach level 60. Above level 60, I will show idols with useful stats for me. Level 50 to 65-ish, I want tier 4 mods at least. And then later on, I want at least tier 5 mods. And above level 80, I'm really looking for exalted items only. So I'm showing everything of tier 6 or higher. Eventually, you want to bump this up to tier 7, but it's outside of the scope of leveling, so I didn't include it in this filter. And I'm recoloring all items that I want to shatter with these rogue-specific chest modifiers specifically. Why am I doing this? Not because I want to use these, but because I want to get these shards. Because if I find an item with one of these mods on it and I want to use a Glove of Chaos, then I need a shard to be able to chaos it. So you want to have at least a few shards of all these in your stash at all time. So that's why I recolor everything. Feel free to change this yourself. I'll put it into the video description so you can import this build. I put it in a paste bin. You can import it by clicking on this plus and then doing paste clipboard content and then just pasting it right in there. I'll update this a little bit actually, because I still have to include other mods that you want to shatter, like potion cleansing, potions cleanse on you, stuff like that. So I'm going to update this a little bit. Yeah, I'll end the video here. Good luck with this build, and if there's any questions, let me know in the comments. And one last thing, last video I mentioned that because we're on low life, we're getting this endurance damage reduction. This is false information, someone pointed out, because actually, as it says here as well, endurance only works on your health and not on your ward. So sadly, we're not getting that extra damage reduction here, but it's still a great defense because we can spam potions and look at our ward go up to 10k for when we need to tank that big hit. So that is why ward is definitely superior to health in the late game as a defense. At least for this build. Well, thanks for watching. Like and subscribe. I might stream on Twitch again someday. Although I've been playing a lot of Final Fantasy Rebirth recently, so who knows. Maybe it'll be a while until I get back into Last Epoch. Alright, peace out. Thanks for watching.